and almost 7 grandchildren. So it really is a pleasure for me to have a good friend to come and speak to us this evening on what we missed in sex ed. Thank you.
And she didn't really make that up. That's really a true story. It is the strangest spot I've ever spoken from. I will give you that. I want to thank all of you for coming tonight, and I promise you that you're going to hear something that you haven't heard before. And if you don't, then you can see Sister Claire to get your money back, okay? She guaranteed returns on, you know, what you paid at the door. But this material is critical for us to understand, because we live in a society that we're really sort of disembodied. Whatever we think in our head is how it should be. So if I'm engaging in sexual activity and I don't want it to have meaning, then it won't, or have any kind of impact, and that's a lie, because you can't turn your body off, all right? So I want to give you a little background on how this came to be, because you're going, why are you talking about this if post-abortion stuff is your specialty? Well, I had a strange experience when I was pregnant with our 4th child. After I had her, I met a neighbor, a priest introduced us. And this person lived down the block from me. We have alleys in Milwaukee, it's on the other side. And about my accent, it's not really Wisconsin, it's Minnesota, just so you know that. I've lived in Wisconsin a long time, but it's still a Minnesota accent. So Joan and I got to be really good friends, and we spent time together watching our kids, walking to school, and doing that sort of thing. And then our 5th kids were born, and they were born a couple months apart. And then our 6th kids were due the same day. And I didn't really think that was going to happen. All right? And we were both on a parish council, so I said to the council, well, the March meeting is going to have to be at St. Mary's Hospital because Joan and I will both be there. And they all rolled their eyes, thinking two women with pregnancy brain on the council cannot be a good thing. So how it really played out is that I went to the hospital on midnight, March 23rd, and my daughter Miriam was born at 7 a.m. on March 24th. Before she was born, Joan is in the next room in labor. All right, now John's birthday is the 25th, but he was born within 24 hours, okay? Weird experience. It's one of those things you tuck in the back of your head, all right? And then go, I don't know. Well, I belong to a group called the Association of Pre- and Perinatal Psychology and Health, and it's the most interesting group I belong to. These are midwives, researchers, doulas, doctors, counselors, therapists, all of whom believe that babies begin at conception, with a small handful who think they begin before conception. I can deal with this, right? And just awesome research. And I was at a conference, and I'm coming home, and I'm reading a book by an anthropologist by the name of Sarah Hurdy on the anthropology of mothering. And she explained what had happened with me and Joan, and I was hooked. And that's why this talk came to be. Because we women, when we spend time together, we'll cycle together. Based on scent hormones called pheromones, I'll talk about this. Those of you who've lived in dorms, you know about this. I've been on campuses where there were boy-girl dorms, and the guys are like, oh my God, that explains that 1 week when we're all gone. I said, yes, it does. But this awareness of the dance that we're in as people, and then the more I learned, the more annoyed I got, because I thought, we need to know this stuff, and nobody's told us. Okay, it's out there, you can find it, but nobody's looking out of it. And I would, you know, speak to the women who had abortions, got pregnant the first time they had sex, and I explained to them why it happened. And they went, I wish I'd known this, because I might not have had to walk where I walked. And then they said, consistently, promise me that you'll tell other people about this. And so out of that promise to them, it is why I'm here with you guys tonight. Okay? Now, as we talk about this, be prepared to be surprised, because there are things where I think you're going to go, really? I had no idea. I was practicing in the back room. I had a couple of people do that. but it's, again, things we need to realize and appreciate about our bodies, okay? And so the first thing that I want to say to you is how interconnected we are as humans, all right? Again, we live in a community, in a society now, where, oh, family doesn't really matter all that much, and you move a lot, mobility is high, change how your genetic code is turned on and off. It doesn't change it. It's just what genes turned on and what ones turned off through something called methylation. All right? So if grandma was in a lot of stress when she was pregnant with your mom, you guys may be very susceptible to stress because all the ovum that your mother ever had, that we women ever have, are present by 20 weeks in utero. That's about halfway through a pregnancy. All right? And there's 6 million of them at that point in that itty-bitty little body. Time you're born is down to about 2 million. And by the time we get our period, we have 400 to 450,000 left. All right? And interestingly, in an average woman's life, we have 400 to 450. So what happened here changed the ovum that are you guys, okay? But now what's unfolding is that you also carry epigenetic changes, especially you men, that's us women, some of them, from our fathers and our grandfathers. So for instance, if your grandfather had a period of time when food was at a minimum, this is originally research done in the famine in the Netherlands after World War II, offspring are predisposed to certain types of cancer, heart issues, diabetes. Fascinating stuff, okay? Much we don't know, much that continues to unfold. This is an ongoing area of some pretty intense research right now. But this connection across generations, okay? But there's more to it than that, all right? And that is that everybody in the world, when was the last time you could hear somebody say that and have them be right? Everybody in the world carries the mitochondria of their mothers. Okay, mitochondria. Now, if you're a ways away from your last biology class, mitochondria are the energy cells in your body, the energy bodies in your cells. And not only do you carry the mitochondria of your mother, but your mother's 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 mother back to 7 lines of women with the scientific implication of an Eve figure. Who would have thought? You can find out National Geographic, Ancestry.com, some other places would be happy to take some of your money. They'll send you a little swab. You send them a little cheek sample, you know, inside, and they'll tell you which of the 7 lines of women you came from and what their migration pattern through history has been. It's fascinating. It's the work of a man who's written about it by the name of Brian Sykes, 7 Daughters of Eve. Then, he wondered if there was something else that had that kind of longevity. He's at a conference, there's another guy named Sykes, people say, are you two related? He says, I don't think so. Gentlemen, your why? Is your father's Y is traceable as the mitochondria, and the Y actually carries some markers. So, for instance, in the Jewish community where there's the tradition of the priestly caste, there's a marker for the priestly caste on the Y. Across generations, okay? This is the time of year when there will be a reading at Mass about who beget, you know, when you nap. Listen this year, because you'll see that there's a woman's line and there's a man's line. How the heck did they know that way back then? What was that about? Okay? But this awareness, again, of how interconnected we are across generations. Right? Where did we come from? Who are we? Now, I want to say a little bit here about men and women. We women, 2 X's, you guys, XY. I've got big news for you, gentlemen. You're the weaker of the 2 sexes. Why? Well, you see, we women have 2 of these, and there's 3,500 to 6,000 genes on one of them, and they balance each other out. So if I have a marker here, say, for colorblindness, as a woman, I am not going to be colorblind, because the other X will balance it out. In our woman bodies, those 2 X's randomly assort themselves. X number 1 might be your heart, X number 2 is your spleen, okay? Identical twin girls from your mother than you do from your father.
You've got 3,500 to 6,000 here.
But about that wine?
It's about 72.
A little simpler?
Different.
The reality is it's different. And so if you've got this X with the color blindness, you're going to be colorblind. All right? Because there's no balance here. More males are conceived than girls, by quite a bit, but they die in utero, right after birth, infancy, toddlerhood, boyhood. By the time you're an adult, it should be about 105 or 106 men to 100 women across the world. Alright? That's the proper balance. Now, we have a problem because we've tipped this in Asia, in parts of Asia, China, India, North Korea, with sex selection abortion. And now we have 125 to 130 something males to 100 women. This is a problem because historically when men outnumber women by that much, the society becomes a little more violent because of the testosterone balance with men. And what's happening in those countries is that in rural areas, parents are selling their 12 to 15 year old daughters to Beijing, to Shanghai, other places to be wives or concubines. The problem is there's a lot of abuse going on. And now in those countries, they have a serious issue with what you do with these women because they run. But they don't know how to get home. They travel thousands of miles from this little itty bitty burg, and some of them might not have even been littering. So I don't know how to get back to where I came from. And it's becoming an issue in terms of the balance, all right? It's important, as we talk about this, as we're gonna talk a little bit about men and women's brains, this isn't about one sex being better than the other. It's about us appreciating our differences, all right? We live in a society that keeps pushing gender neutrality. And this started when our kids were little. And the concept was that if we only gave our girls trucks and our boys dolls, that would make them more neutral. Well, we tried it. All of our girls got trucks. And they gave them names, and they wrapped them in blankets, and they had parties, and they had naps. And I think only one of my daughters cheated to see if a wheel came off. And the only reason I suspicion that is that of all my daughters, she's the one who knows how to change the brakes on her car. Right? She's never admitted to it, but I suspicion, maybe. Sons are 8 years apart. First son got a doll, discovered that the doll made a great football. And he and the kid down the block wore it out in about 2.5 weeks. And never had a name or a party. It was sad. We had to throw it out. It was a mess. Son number two got a doll, and it was a buddy doll. Buddy dolls were boy dolls and they had tools. And they're pretty cool. My son really liked his doll. And then one Saturday, my husband and I went to the grocery store, and the elder siblings were babysitting, and son number one decided they should play a game. And the game was called Sacrifice the Buddy Doll. And it's not a girl game. And my son only told me about it a few years ago, and you know, the only answer I had for him is that I was really sorry that that happened. And then in midlife, when he had to go to counseling, because we all do know that's part of your transition, he had something to talk about. And he said, yes, I do. We think perhaps there's more in the story than sacrificing the buddy doll. All right, but you know, those of you who have older siblings, you appreciate that. But this awareness that in society somehow we aren't encouraged to embrace our uniqueness, our feminism, our masculinism, we're not encouraged to do that. And we need it because we're built for complementarity, all right? And as I talk about this, I'm going to talk briefly about the difference in men and women's brains, because honest to goodness, there's differences. I know that's shocking to you, but there are. You know, the other thing is you've got people writing books like Pink Brain, Blue Brain, and making proposals like this. The reason that you behave as a female or a male is because your parents dressed you in pink or dressed you in blue. I didn't use either of those colors for my kids, okay? And they did an experiment. They had a bunch of little monkeys, boys and girls, and they gave them a big pile of toys, and there were fuzzy, you know, cuddly toys, and there were boy toys, you know, blocks and balls and things like that. Do you know those boy monkeys picked the boy toys? And the girl monkeys picked the girl toys?
And the Y kicks in. There's a little marker there called an SRY. And that's what begins the development of the male body. All right? It suppresses the female hormones, male genitalia develops, and the hormones change how the body and the brain develop. Okay? Now, many years ago, I had a conference, and I had a Canadian psychiatrist, a guy, and a Catholic sister from California. She's a therapist, and they had a long discussion over dinner. Now, this is before the, you know, Mars and Venus books and spaghetti and waffles books. And this is what they concluded, and then all the books came out and supported what they said. This would be an image of a male brain. It is a series of boxes. The gift men have is of being able to be single focused. We women don't have that gift. All right? Now, let me say this. Some women are linear thinkers. Some men are what I call triage thinkers, multitaskers. You just have to know how you think. But predominantly men are single focused. Long ago, you guys were hunters and you were seafarers. You were doing dangerous things. You had to be able to be absolutely focused, all right? Because if you were out, you know, skipping through the woods looking at butterflies, you were likely to become lunch for something as opposed to bringing lunch home, all right? Males operate in testosterone-driven systems. When you guys were little and you did the push, shove, wrestle business, what you were determining is who the dominant male in your community was. Why did you need that? Because when you were hunters and seafarers, you needed a leader. And if you live in that same community through your adolescent years, most likely that guy is still the leader. All right? It's a different system than we women work off of. Okay? But this ability to be focused is important for us to appreciate. All right? I was out in California. There's a guy out here who runs a school. And in this school, there are boy classrooms and girl classrooms from kindergarten through 12th grade. Because guys and girls learn differently. And many of us have suffered, you guys in particular, because our classrooms tend to be female-driven classrooms. Alright? You guys can only take one command at a time. Women, pay attention. Alright? Classroom. Teacher says, take out your paper, your pencil, and put your name at the top of the page. Hey, we girls are all over that. You guys don't get any further than this. Airplane. Spitball. Picture. Teacher says, pay attention! Or attention deficit disorder. No, it's a difference in how we think. Work of a man by the name of Leonard Sykes, Saxon, and some other guys have really done some interesting stuff on this. Alright? But that awareness of difference. Alright? Now, what he told me, and I've been married to my husband for 43 years, and I did not know this. Is that one of these boxes is empty. And so when we talk to the man in our life, and we say, what are you thinking about? And he says, nothing. It's true. He can do that. All right? But you see, this comes in part from when men hunted. They would do fire gazing at the end of the day. They would gather. They would build a fire. They would sit companionably side by side and basically not talk about much. Same thing happens in bars. You see that football play? Okay. Just so you know where the behaviors come from, I'm just trying to be helpful. All right. Now, we women have what I call a triage brain. Because we lived together in a community while you guys were gone. All right. Now, this business about why women cycle together is driven by something called pheromones. You'll hear me speak more about them. They are scent molecules of affiliation that communicate things about people we're related to. All right? We women will cycle because when we lived in that community, if I had a baby and I died, somebody else in that community had to be able to nurse my baby or my baby would die. All right? Doesn't have to be a relative. Kin are relatives by intention. This was a kinship community. All right? So we women needed to be cycling together so that our babies stood a chance of surviving, all right? Now, we women, because we lived in a confined area where we knew the turf, we can do the following because we can keep more things in the air at one time. You know, the cat's thrown up, the toddler's got outside, supper's burning, and I have to go to the bathroom, and usually there's not a casualty there, all right? Because we can keep that stuff going in our head, all right? Men know, you'll talk to people and you leave your husband home with the kids and supper. And then you come back and you go, dear, where are the kids? Kids. Next door? Or, then he says, but look, we're having barbecue for supper. See the fire? Okay. Or vice versa, I'll supper, dear. Supper. I bet that's what I smell, huh? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yes, I bet it is. Okay. But we had to be able to be on alert to keep track of threats. Where was food? Because we were gatherers, they were hunters. Okay. And so we have this ability to keep more things in the air, but we can't focus like that. It's very difficult for us to do that. All right? Men and women's brains are different in that we women have our language spots scattered around our brain, and our emotional centers are near them. There's a lot of them. We can emote at the drop of a hat.
True.
Yeah. Guys have their language on the left side of the brain. Your feeling center is near the amygdala, which is the fear center of the brain. And when we say to the men in our life, tell me how you feel, he can't do that. He has to think about it. And we get mad.
Well, tell me how you feel. I don't know how I feel.
No, he doesn't. He has to stop, think about it, go retrieve it, come back, and now I can talk about it. Just stuff we need to know. All right? When men are reading, don't talk to them and expect them to know what you said. Because the part of the brain where hearing lies when they're reading is dead, not turned on. I still talk to my husband when he reads the paper, but I do check to see if he heard me. Dear, did you hear what I said? No. What did you say, dear? Okay. It's appreciating the differences. Okay? So that awareness of different pieces, okay? We girls, because of that double X business, have a lot more rods and cones in terms of color. We have much finer color discrimination in terms of visual determining, looking at something, than guys do. Alright? We can, that's some shade, you know? For guys, it's difficult because they don't have the same arrangement, all right? You know, we girls, when we're little, we draw nouns. Love, flowers, butterflies, lots of colors. Guys, you draw birds. Exploding things, driving things, okay? Maybe a little stick figure. And basically in blues and grays and blacks, different tonal qualities, okay? Men have better distance vision. We have better peripheral vision. We're better daytime drivers. They're better nighttime drivers, okay? There's just a ton of these subtle differences. Men like sweet flavors more than we do. There's more discrimination there, okay? We women, there's different kinds of hearing. If he's sleeping and a stick snaps in the yard, he's on it. Baby can be crying for hours, nothing there. Soon as the baby whimpers, we're on top of it. But we didn't hear the stick. Okay? Again, a difference in how we're made, and that we need to appreciate that. Because it, you know, when you think about it, there is such wisdom there, and it's awesome. You know, boys learn better when they're moving around. In this classroom, this guy has his school, they have tall tables like any that you find in coffee shops, because the boys will stand up and work at the table. Because men's brains work better when their body is moving. Okay? You know, we can sit at the desk and take all the, you know, give us all the commands, all that sort of thing. For men, hearing women's voices in classrooms, if the boys in the back of the room, he might really have trouble with that. Just because of pitch. We have a male teacher as women, we think he's yelling at us because his voice is louder and gruffer, okay? And it's not any of those, but it's just our perception of that, you know, and how that works. There's actually a stage for boys somewhere around 11 where there's growth going on in the ear canal, and they lose some of their acute hearing for a little while. Now, again, in the classroom, he's not going to be able to hear what's going on. But the differences that are here, you know, we shop kind of based on this, okay? Guys shop like hunters. They're going to the store to get the blue shirt. Don't you want a yellow shirt? No. Do you want to go to the other store? It's on sale. No. Okay. I'm going to get it and then come back. My husband just found this great quote. The guy said, I go buying. I don't go shopping. All right? Now, guys do like to go buying slash shopping if it's a hands-on store. Electronics, hunting, you know, anything that they can manipulate. The hardware store. Hardware store is fun. You know, for us women, it's a whole different ballgame. When we shop, it's a process. Do we know what we're looking for? Not usually. We're gatherers. Oh, the blue shoes. I've been waiting 6 months for those shoes to be on sale. Okay? Just the awareness of difference in how we approach things. Okay? How we give directions. If I took you guys outside in the dark, someplace you didn't know, and I said, find north, almost all of you will not immediately be able to point to true north. You have a little section of your brain that is very similar to the part of the brain in birds and butterflies that migrate thousands of miles and return to the same spot every year. That was very helpful to you when you were hunting and you were seafaring, because there was no GPS. There was no sign that said Virginia that way, okay? You had to know how to get home. We women don't have that, all right? When men give directions, they oftentimes do north, south, east, west, so far, make a left. When we give women give directions, we give them more like this. You know where the green church is? Yeah, well, you go down to the green church, and then you make a right, and then there's that house that has the red porch and the big tree, and we're all going all along. The guys are like, what the fuck are you talking about? All right. It's the difference because we lived in this confined community. We all knew where the landmarks were. We knew where the blueberry patch was. We knew where the big tree was. The guys didn't know that because they weren't there. Okay, they were spread out and much further afield than we were. Okay, so just things to be aware of and to appreciate about each other. All right, now there are many things when we talk about relationships and about intimacy that we've not been told. And there are things that we really need to be aware of. So this first thing is this pheromone issue and how we women will enter into menstrual synchronicity is what it's called if we live together. But we need to know that if we're chemically contracepting, it doesn't work. We will not be in sync with the other women because our body thinks it's pregnant and it's with somebody else, all right? And interestingly, there is oftentimes a dominant female who will set the cycle for the other women. It takes about 3 months for a woman to come into, you know, to be cycling together, okay? But now there's something else, and that is when we women meet a guy, the first thing we observe about him is how he smells. And it's not aftershave, though interestingly, our aftershave and our perfume matches our own scent. If I gave you three piles of t-shirts, yours, generic female, generic male, 8 out of 10 of you will identify yours immediately. 7 out of 10 of you will discriminate male from female. All right? The overarching description is that females tend to smell sweet and males smell like musk, which is why it is a component in many colognes and aftershaves. It's a distinctly male scent. But that's like the broadest scope because there are very fine discriminations within this. Okay? Now, we women have a gift from God. When we meet a male and he smells good to us, what that indicates is that our immune system is quite different. All right? This is something called the MHC complex, all right? Major histocompatibility complex. And this is the possibility of fertility. This little overlap here has to do with our father's immune system. All right? But the rest of this is quite different. Now, if I'm chemically contracepting, it changes my preference for pheromone. And I am now attracted to a male whose immune system is very much like my father or my brother or my own. This is a problem because it becomes a fertility challenge to begin with. And if I go off the chemical contraceptives, I no longer find my partner attractive to me anymore. He smells biologically adverse. And I'm not talking about body odor, I'm talking about this unique pheromone scent. Pheromones are perceived by two pits in the septum of your nose, right about here, and they communicate with a unique nerve in the brain that only has to do with pheromones. It's located right here. It's very small, it's very fragile. It's separate from your olfactory nerve. Okay, but as I said, when we buy perfume or aftershave, we recognize whether it smells like us. Because, you know, you go in the perfume store and or the clones and you go, ugh. That's because it doesn't smell like you. All right? It's one of those sort of unseen pieces. But this awareness is a pretty serious one. You know, I don't know if any of you saw that this week there were things bouncing around Facebook and a couple other places on a piece of research on how women on the pill prefer men whose faces, they're not so handsome. It's an interesting description. When we are ovulating and not contracepting, we're looking for a mate, all right? And that's when we're looking for the good-looking guy.
Yeah.
But when we're in this other mode, and that has to do with this pheromone thing, they weren't talking about pheromones. They were just doing this research of men, of women's preference for appearance. But it's very interesting stuff, okay? Now, there's a lot of stuff going on here, all right? And one of the things we need to know is that we women, excuse me, when we're ovulating, all right, we dress to impress. Did you know that? Hair's a little better, makeup's a little better, a little décolletage. Did study in Canada, followed women through cycles, did spit tests to determine hormones, gave pictures to strangers. Those strangers pretty accurately picked out the ovulating woman. Amazing. Okay? Now, to talk just a little about our cycle, we women have two ovaries that are the size of almonds, so they're very small. You have two fallopian tubes. This is not 100% accurate. Drawing, but I don't have time. Alright? But what's interesting is your fallopian tubes are not connected to your ovaries. Did you know that? When you ovulate out into your abdominal cavity. And there are little cilia, little hair-like projections here that create a suction. Alright? We alternate signs every month. And so one sign will have about 10 ovum that get prepared. Something triggers which ones will actually be released into the body, all right? And this being sort of a diagram of our cycle, okay, here's your period on this side. Then the first phase over here, and the chemistry is different in each one of these, is called the follicular phase. That's when these follicles are developing. About 12 days before your next period is ovulation, all right? The next phase over here is called luteal. And then you're either pregnant or you get your period. All right, now. I want to talk about that because do you realize what a small window in your cycle you're really fertile? That ovum only lives 24 hours. All right, 24 hours. And sperm can live up to about 5 days. All right. Nature signals this stuff when we're ovulating because reproduction is important. All right. So this question about women dressing to impress, all right? We, by pheromones, smell different to the men around us when we're ovulating. Men respond to ovulating women with elevated testosterone, sexual arousal, and potential aggression. This is date rape stuff, all right? Because we're in the bar, we have a few drinks. We are very, very arousable at this point. Plus, we're looking pretty good, all right? And the alcohol didn't help necessarily to make her choices better, right? But that awareness, we have to be aware. And it's very funny because in our family, we have one daughter who I refer to as Miss Never Had an Unspoken Thought. And I was sharing this information with she and her younger sister one day. Well, I had shared it. And she and I are sitting at the table and my youngest daughter comes down. And she's kind of my most conservative dresser in terms of normal stuff. She's got makeup and hair's done and décolletage, and her big sister says, "Why are you ovulating? We'll put your clothes on." I know a little knowledge can be a dangerous thing. But just that awareness, okay? To understand that we're designed to be in this dance together, all right? Now, let's go back here. So one or two of them are released. We need to know that one in eight of us was conceived as a twin. We're not born as a twin, we're conceived as a twin. And our twin was lost early on in a little bleeding episode, a little miscarriage. Maybe we absorbed our twin. Anybody with two colored eyes, it's an absorbed twin.
Teratomas are tumors that have teeth and hair in them. Those are an absorbed twin. This awareness that we have a knowledge that someone's missing in our life because we carry cells from that twin. We have biological knowledge, and I'll say more about that in a minute. All right. Now, the ovum has been released. The cilia are working. We need to know that there are three types of sperm. Work by of a man by the name of Robin Baker. There are egg getters. You'll see these are highly technical terms. Blockers and killers. And egg getters are 1%. Blockers are 83%. And killers are 16%. All right. Egg getters are the sleek sperm that we associate with conception. And what's interesting is that egg getters are incapable of entering an ovum unless they are biologically changed in the body of your woman partner. It's something called capacitation. And they stop somewhere right here. Takes 3 to 7 hours. And there's a difference in the timing here. But now they're changed. And now the head is capable of what's called the acrosome reaction, which is to enter, okay, the ovum. And it swims differently. It swims with more intent, right? Blockers fill in crypts in the cervix so that the egg getters can get through. And killers, for the most part, are benign, unless we women have had multiple partners in a short period of time. In which case, the killers are highly poisonous, and their intent is to kill the sperm of any other males who we've had sex with, because it's all about who gets the sperm to the ovum. Do you see some sports analogies here? Because I think there are some, okay? But this awareness, because if I've had multiple partners and I have this reaction going on, I might now be more susceptible to a particular infection called bacterial vaginosis. What that does, we women, our bodies are for the most part acidic. Male bodies are alkaline. The last thing that's put on sperm before it leaves your body is vitamin C to make it acidic so that it isn't immediately neutralized in the woman's body. But when we have this multiple partner thing going on, our body can become alkaline. And when that happens, we may get an infection with anaerobic bacteria, which is very serious and needs to be treated ASAP. Okay? So this awareness of the complexity of what's happening here, okay? This isn't just a simple, you know, for sure we can get pregnant. The reality is, there's so many things that can go wrong. The fact that any of us has ever conceived is a miracle. All right? We are told in our society that, for instance, THC in pot is benign. I mean, pot is just, you know, it's a wonderful drug. You know, it's got no consequences. Well, in case you want to know, it does. It damages sperm. No questions asked. Slows down, causes it to swim incorrectly, and if you have a low sperm count, it may leave you infertile. Now, the other thing is this. Sperm, or THC, is related to the hormones, the chemistry involved here. If THC is present, it may block the receptor sites here, or when the baby is coming down to implant, because the placenta area is prepared for the baby, this chemistry here is also related, and THC may also block that. All right? We gentlemen, and you gentlemen, need to know you should not carry your cell phone in your pants pocket. Radiation damages sperm, no questions asked. Very serious research. Do not work with laptops directly on your lap without some kind of protection. Same thing, radiation damages sperm. Find a different place to carry your phone. You know, get one of those, the little carriers that have the protection against the radiation, carry it on your belt. Get it away from immediately on your body. Women, they're talking about the fact that we may also have damage from using cell phones, iPads. There's a lot of radiation going on there. We haven't looked as much at women's bodies. But same thing, don't carry your phone here, all right? We just need to be conscious of those things because they're very significant, okay? Now, let me move on here. There's something else that's very fascinating. Well, there's a couple things. Are we moving our cell phones? Good, all right. In high school, this is where they all go, all right? Everybody in the world, all right?
they're passed in through the placenta. When I'm pregnant, by 4 weeks, which is before I know for sure I'm pregnant, I've already got the cells of my baby in my body. You can extract them from my bloodstream. All right? Now, there's more to this, however. You guys carry the cells of your mothers. We women carry your cells by 4 weeks. It takes about 13 weeks for vice versa. Okay? But they're there, and there's a lot of them. Okay? How many of you have older brothers and sisters? Okay, raise your hands. Guess whose cells you carry? Your mother gave them to you in pregnancy. They're there. My youngest daughter concluded that she must have gotten the better cells or best cells of her older brothers and sisters because she is by far my exceptional child, and you can use that if it makes you feel better. All right. What's interesting about this, there's several things. If this is my partner, remember what I said? This being my partner? These cells in my mother's body appear to try and repair things that don't work right. If these are the cells, they may be a causal factor in autoimmune diseases in me, the mother. All right? Now, those cells in my children, if my child is born with an anomaly, they cluster. Like they're trying to fix it. Remarkable. All right? But there's even more. There's an oncologist in Pennsylvania who was at one of my talks who said, I have to tell you about my research. And here's his research. When a woman has a tumor, he checks to see if this is her partner. This is kind of match, okay, the complementary partner. If she has sons, okay, he extracts the sun cells from her body, injects them into the tumors, and they disappear without consequence. How awesome is that? Now, why sun cells? Because in my XX body, you have to do high-tech genetics to determine what cells are mine and what cells are my daughter's. If it's XY, it's not me. Okay? Remarkable. All right? Remarkable. The other thing is that if you've lost an older brother or sister through a miscarriage or through an abortion, you oftentimes know that. All right? I met the people who say, I always thought I should have an older brother and an older sister. In our extended family, there's a nephew whose mom had an abortion before she married into our family. And she had told one of his sisters, who told Miss Never Had an Unspoken Thought, who shared it with the youngest sister, but that's as far as the information went. And this daughter and that cousin lived across the street from each other from the time they were born. They're almost 6 weeks apart. They're like twins. I mean, there's this real bond there. His parents had moved to Florida, and he was living with us. He was in his early 20s, and he said to my daughter one day, well, the two daughters are at the table with him, and he said, I always thought I was supposed to have an older brother. And she said, to him, you do. His name is Christopher. Your mother had an abortion before she married your dad, and my nephew wept from the depth of his soul for his brother. He just wept. That knowledge of who's in our family system, that we aren't always conscious of, but the sense that someone's missing, okay? That question of a twin. One of my daughters, my eldest daughter, was a twin, but I didn't know it at the time. I had this little bleeding episode after a miscarriage, and then I was pregnant, and she was born premature for anticipated due date, but she was a full-term baby. So I was like, I'm gonna be pregnant, you know, back when I had that bleeding thing. Okay, no more thought given to it. And then, when she was about 15, I was giving one of my talks, and someone gave me an article on how often this twinning thing happens. And I knew she was a twin. Now, I didn't know about carrying cells at that point, but I knew she was a twin. And I told my husband, I told a friend of mine, and I decided I wasn't going to tell her. God had to tell her. I literally said that to God. Be careful what you say. And it took 2 months, and she woke me up at 2 in the morning, and she said, Mom, I was praying, and I think I'm a twin. I said, I think you are too. Is it a boy or a girl? She goes, it's a boy. His name is Joseph Francis. This explains why I'm so bonded to the brother behind me and why all of my best friends have always been guys. Absolutely accurate. Okay? We need to grieve for those children who are part of our families that we don't always see. But that awareness of impact. Now, there's some other awesome things out here. Did you know that if you take cancer cells, 40 different kinds, put them in the petri dishes, put breast milk on them. Breast milk kills 40 kinds of cancer on contact.
knowledge granted two substances from it. One is called Hamlet. Forget what the second one is, and they are using it in this country to treat prostate cancer very effectively. There's a woman in Scandinavia using it to treat brain tumors. Awesome, right? When we nurse our babies, one of the things that we give them is bacteria. There's a number of bacteria in early breast milk, right? Just recently discovered in the last few years. And they had never seen these kind of bacteria before. And they weren't quite sure what they did. But what they do is they colonize our gut. And then there are these long-chain sugars, which they thought fed the baby, but it turns out feed the good bacteria and kill the bad bacteria. Right? When we are born in the vaginal canal, our body is inoculated with the bacteria of our mothers so that we have a naturally familial biome going on. All right? If we are born by C-section, we might have gut problems later because we didn't get the bacteria that we were supposed to get. If we were bottle-fed, changes the whole dynamic. All right? And just recently, this week, all right, I found this awesome article that started me thinking about all kinds of things. The title? A 10-second kiss is long enough to transfer 80 million bacteria. Okay, think about that. But what happens is, literally, they have tested your partner, you have a committed partner, spouse, you guys now share bacteria types, all right? Now, I've been thinking about, so if I have the bacteria of my husband in my body, I am transferring this to my children through the placenta, the child is being exposed to the biome of both families, okay? That's my only thought on this. It's really interesting stuff. But this question again of how much and how closely we are interrelated is an important piece, okay? Now, we need to know that it takes 6 months of exposure to the sperm of our partner for our body to say, ah, that's my partner. Sperm are laden with antigens so that my body has that reaction. Footnote, gentlemen, the problem with vasectomies is that your sperm and your blood meet for the very first time, and it sets off an autoimmune reaction in you. Even if you fix it, it doesn't matter because you've already triggered it. And one of the pieces of research on men who have vasectomies is that many of them get very serious autoimmune diseases, certain types of arthritis and other things. Okay? We aren't told this stuff, but we need to know it. All right? So it takes my body 6 months to adapt to the sperm of my partner. Now, I can get pregnant first time, all right? But I'm more likely to get something like preeclampsia or one of those autoimmune reactions because my body isn't used to this partner sperm yet, okay? Very interesting stuff, all right? In the old days, back in the 30s, the doctors wrote about the fact that when women got married and they hadn't been sexually active, it took about 7 to 8 months for their uterus to go from immature to mature. I can't find what this immature means. I don't know, all right? But that was their language. At that point, pregnancy occurred. And they observed that people who used condoms were oftentimes left infertile. That her body never made this transition to a fully mature uterus. Again, I can't find the specifics about that. But it's very interesting. Now, why would that be? Because seminal fluid is one of the most complex fluids in the human body, maybe the most. There are more than 30 compounds in there. Things like zinc, things like different kinds of sugars. Zinc is for our women immune system to protect us. Sugars have to do with how the sperm swims and all. I mean, there's a ton of complex chemistry in there. And there's a ton of hormones. 13 kinds of prostaglandins, follicle-stimulating hormone, luteinizing hormone. Oh, wait a minute, those are women hormones. You bet. We women absorb them for 15 hours after reactive intercourse. Follicle-stimulating hormone and luteinizing hormone may have had to do with the maturity of the uterus that I was talking about, okay? That chemistry is triggering our own bodies. In the very old days, we need to know that women didn't have 28-day cycles until they had their partner. And once they had their mate, then their cycle became regular. What's that about?
That's how nature worked. But I think it's a combination of pheromones and the absorption of chemistry. Now,
but you say, well, okay, but hey, we're going to use condoms. The problem with condoms is you're not getting the benefit of the seminal fluid. We know that in husbands and wives where there's depression, when the woman has regular intercourse with her partner that's unprotected, her depression lifts because of the serotonin and dopamine that are in seminal fluid. Hello? Who would have thought? Okay. But I'm not really being changed by this because we're using condoms. Wrong, because you cannot turn off the chemistry of bonding in your body. When you are in an intimate relationship, touching someone, you get oxytocin, which is a bonder. You guys get vasopressin, which gives you preference for this female and makes you jealous. You can't turn it off, okay? You can walk away, but you can't turn it off. So every time we are engaged in intimacy, we are being biologically changed by that intimacy, okay? We are designed for one partner, okay? Because think about this. If I've had multiple partners, one, I've absorbed all that seminal fluid, and nobody knows quite what happens to our bodies, but it has to do something, all right? But if I've conceived children with different partners, that becomes an issue because I'm carrying all that DNA from these various men, okay? And I'm passing those cells on to my other children who are not 100% biologically related. And this could become an issue. And again, it's stuff we have to think about. Nobody's told us about it, but we need to be conscious of the changes that occur in our systems because of this. Now, we also need to know that, you know, we're told that, you know, gosh, the pill is just such a wonderful gift to humanity and all those sorts of things. And we need to know that there are some serious issues that are involved in that, okay? You know, the possibility that we might get a blood clot, okay? We go, well, but it's not very often. If it's you and you die, it's 100%. And why do I raise that? I raise that because my daughter's best friend died 4 years ago on a campus. Collapsed, full of blood clots, on the pill for health reasons. They got them out of her heart, and they got them out of her lungs, but they didn't get them out of the rest of her body. And she was awake, and her parents had to tell her that they were going to let her die. It was a big waste of her life. Cindy was an awesome woman. It shouldn't have happened. You know, doctors in theory could test to see if we have the clotting factor or not. But you know what? They don't. And that's an issue. And the problem is we don't even know for sure whether we're going to react because it also depends on our blood type and some other things. Now, there's other things. When we live and are on the pill, there are nutritional deficiencies. We need to know that. Can impact our gallbladder. Changes the uterine, changes the cervical mucus, so we are predisposed to get certain STDs. If you are exposed to one of the precancerous HPVs, you're going to get it, even with Gardasil, because it's not 100% in terms of the different types, because it changes the cervical mucus and you're no longer protected. All right, we need to know those things. Women's brains, when you're on the pill, when they do brain scans, after a while, our brains begin to grow like male brains. We women perceive things differently. It's something called emotional memory, all right? If I show you a picture, you know, we got a big picture of an accident up here. You guys are going to hone in on the core of the accident. We women will see the core and the peripherals. Okay, so there's a dog over there, there's a lady over here. Women on the pill see it as a male. It changes how we perceive things, all right? This question about picking the wrong partner is a very serious issue, all right? Research is out there on the fact that divorce is followed. Why? In part because libido is gone. And then if I go off the pill, I don't find them attractive anymore. And the relationship takes a nosedive. About 50% of women on the pill are depressed. When you go to the doctor and talk to him about his depression, your depression, does he ask you if you're on the pill? Because he should, okay? These are very serious issues that we need to be conscious of. Now, think about this. We live in a society where many, 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 many women are on the pill. That means you guys are not in the biological dance because she is not smelling fertile. What does that mean to a culture? I think it's got with pornography. Because you're supposed to be in this fertility dance, for want of a different term, with the women around you. If you're surrounded by women who are flatlined in terms of fertility, you guys are not having your normal biological response to that. Can also lead to infidelity. Because, you know, that woman at work, once a month, oh, she makes my heart go bare, Pat. I don't feel this way about my wife, but we don't know why. Okay, but I don't feel this way about my wife. I must be in love. And now there's an infidelity, and now there's a bunch of broken hearts. Okay? So we have to be conscious of these things. It's very important to us. And it's interesting, I gave this talk one time at a Protestant church, and there were two college guys there. And they came up and they said, Mrs. Thorn, we just had a discussion. Yes, gentlemen? We have come to a conclusion. Yes, gentlemen? If some girl's interested in us, the first thing we're going to ask her is if she's on the pill. Because we have to decide if she's worth our time or not. That was the first one that had ever come up. But I thought it was a pretty good conclusion. All right? But as humans, we need to understand. You know, in every country where the pill was introduced, within 6 months, male fertility fell like a rock. It drops about 50%. There's a man by the name of Lionel Twiger, who's an anthropologist, who believes that chemical contraceptives changed men as well as women, that it changed the relationship. And the research has been repeated, but the first research was this. He took a colony of monkeys to an island. There was one male, and the male was Austin. And Austin was absolutely faithful to three of the females. Those were his consorts. He did not look at the other females. Put those three in chemical contraceptives, he lost interest. He took up with three others. Put all the females in the community on contraceptives, and Austin fared poorly. Sperm count crashed and burned. No more contact with females. He began to masturbate excessively. When they took the females off, masturbation disappeared. Sperm count came back, and he went back to his first three females, to whom he was very faithful. Okay? So it isn't only women who are impacted by this. Okay? The awareness that we also live in a society where pornography is running rampant. We have to know that that's a fantasy, okay? It's not really sex. The part of the brain that's impacted isn't sexual. It's the part of the brain where cocaine and heroin lie, okay? It is an addiction. And we need to escalate in terms of the grossness, for want of a better term, because we need more stimulation, more stimulation, more stimulation to have a response. You know, women, we can't put up with that because you're never going to compete with those women. He can change women at the click of a mouse. As soon as you make a demand, honey, you are all done, okay? Because those fantasy women make no demands. But it's not real human interaction. And we need, as couples, to talk about this. There is an online recovery site that's Catholic. And I apologize, I ran out of cards. I was just someplace else and I gave them all out. It's called Reclaim. It uses the Candido model of recovery. It's very effective. But we need to know how to get help for those things, because those things destroy our relationships. They destroy the people that we're with, and we have to understand that, okay? It's not benign. It is not without consequence. And so those are things we have to be aware of. The other thing is that cohabitation is not marriage. And people who cohabitate have a much higher risk of divorce should they marry. They break up. There's more abuse, physical and emotional. Also, interestingly, with pornography use, there's more physical abuse and infidelity. And couples who don't want girl children in particular. And, you know, it's just an interesting piece of research. But we have to be conscious of these things and be willing to speak about them. Because we live in a society where there's so much brokenness, okay? Back to cohabitation for a minute, okay? You know, if I'm cohabiting, I'm probably on the pill because we're not really ready to have kids yet. So it might be the wrong partner for starters. But we also find that this whole question of the male setting off our pheromones, potentially having the pill fail, which does happen, there's more depression there. The couples report that sex is not as good. There's more sort of fear and hesitation. There's more fights. There's more, as I said, both physical and sexual abuse, or sexual and physical abuse there. There's this whole domestic violence issue is a real serious one.
That's not what we're called to be. That's not who we're called to be. We are called to find our life partner, all right? And to grow in love. And scripture says to become one. When I'm carrying the DNA of my partner, people, that's becoming one. When men are changed, that's becoming one. And let's talk for just a minute about how men are changed by pregnancy, because we need to understand that. We live in a society that has really discounted you men in terms of this whole sexuality parenting thing, all right? Now, when you are with your pregnant partner, by 4 weeks, she smells different. You recognize it as pregnancy, and your body changes. And the first thing that happens is you get more cortisol. Now, cortisol is a stress hormone, but it's also a bonding protector hormone. And this is bonding and protection, all right? 60 to 90% of men who are with their pregnant partners will experience symptoms of pregnancy. It's called Coulon. Now, in our culture, doctors, for the most part, don't know about that, all right? There is one. His wife was at one of my talks. She said just yesterday there was a pregnant woman in his office, and her husband was with him, and her husband described the symptoms, and her husband said, "Oh, that's not related to pregnancy. I'm on a woman telling her." So somewhere in this country, there's one doctor who knows. But what happens is 20% of these guys are really sick, and they all go to the doctor. And they say something like this, "I'm really sick, I'm thrown up, and I'm nauseous, and I have headaches and backaches, toothaches are a big deal, I'm fatigued, I'm just not feeling good, I have food cravings, and I've gained weight," which you might not confess to, but it's part of it. And the doctor says, "Oh, that's a virus, it'll go away. And I'll tell you right when it goes away, all right?" But you know what's interesting about these guys who are sick? When the baby's born, they already can distinguish hunger from tired from other cries. They're hardwired, all right? Now, what's interesting is that about 6 weeks before the baby comes, there's a bunch more chemistry shifting. His testosterone drops pretty radically, okay? Less likely to wander and be aggressive. His estrogen, because men do have estrogen, goes up. Kinder, tender, more protective, all right? More cortisol to protect. That vasopressin that I talked about, we women have a little of it, but it's predominantly a male hormone. And right now, this is Mother Nature. Sit, stay, do not abandon. And then our father gets prolactin. That's the nursing hormone. He's got it for 6 weeks. He's really nice. Take note, women. Starbucks, they have diapers in the night. And you can tell when it's going away when you say, "Dear, it's 11:30, could you get me some Starbucks and diapers?" And he says, "Starbucks at 11:30 at night? And why didn't you call me at the office about the diapers?" Okay? You can see that there's a shift happening here. But you know what's interesting? With every subsequent child he fathers, he gets more prolactin every time. Nature says more responsibilities, more assistance. It's awesome when you think about it. In the animal kingdom, and there is some research on men, always done the research I'd like to see done, but where the monkeys actually, the male monkeys help parents, they carry the young and spend time with them, guess what? They get new brain cells in the prefrontal cortex, which helps them to make decisions. And they last until the young become independent. And there seems to be some of this going on in human males as well, but nobody's done that kind of research. The research tends to be Canadian and British, okay? Americans have ignored you guys for the most part. You're interested in that. There's an article in Slate. There's an article in USA Today. You put in, you know, men pregnancy hormones, and you'll find the research. But we need to see how complex all of this is, all right? To truly appreciate how it is that we're made, and to be able to embrace that, because that sets us free. It's the truth that sets us free. And so to be conscious of this, to make those decisions, to talk about things. You know, we need to know that in a room of people 18 to 25 who have been sexually active, one half of them already have a sexually transmitted disease. That's a lot. You know, I talk to teenagers and, you know, they're thinking about being sexually active or they have that, and I say to them, "What, to the girls, did you ask him if he has an STD?" "Oh, no. Did you, like, look for lesions or anything?" "No. Why not?" "I don't
don't know him well enough. Well, I see, you're going to have sex with him, but you don't know him well enough to ask if he's got an STD that you're going to carry the rest of your life. Throw me that picture. And guys don't wake up with STDs. We live in a society where this has become the norm. I don't know if you guys know this, there's a major epidemic of throat and mouth cancer ever caused by oral sex, because HPV is an equal opportunity infection. We're just not told this stuff. And we need to be making those decisions and knowing enough to be able to make good decisions. So it's my hope that this has been helpful for you. Again, if you didn't learn anything, see Sister Claire. And I'm around for questions. We can take private questions. Do you want to take them from the floor, Sister?
A couple more?
If anybody's got a couple, I'll be around. And these are for sale. This is my talk that I gave here. Where was I? What parish was I in?
St. Thomas
Becket. St. Thomas Becket. A year and a half, 2 years ago. Ron has some copies back there. So if you're interested, you can take it home and share it with your friends and ruin their evening too. But if anybody's got a question, otherwise I'll be here. Feel free to ask me, because sometimes I know questions you don't want to ask from the floor. And let me give you an email address. You know, you go home and you think about it, and you go, got something that's bothering you, feel free. Okay, Vicki Thorn, VickiThorn, 2004, at yahoo.com. All right? Now, when I travel, I do not travel with a computer because my days are very full. So if you don't hear from me right away, don't panic. But if you haven't heard from me in about 2 weeks, write again, because stuff also goes off into the cloud or wherever it goes, you know how the days happen. That's the Lord who sent it. But I'll be happy to do the best I can to point you to something to answer your question, whatever I can do. And it has been filmed right back here, and I think it's going to be up on YouTube. So feel free to take a look. There's other things I've done up there as well. So thank you all very much, and come up with questions, and there's drinks.
I have a question regarding the cells of sons curing cancer in their mothers. Mm-hmm. I think that was what you said. Does the reverse work? Can the cells of a daughter cure cancer in her father?
The reason it's son cells, daughter cells would work too, but it's just harder to get them out, to extract them. We know that it's actually mother-child in terms of some of those other transplant things that work a little better than child-father, okay? But nobody's looked at that I know of in terms of the father connection there, okay? Anybody else? Yes.
Can you explain what you were talking about with if someone had a C-section, what were they missing that gave them?
What they're missing if we have a C-section, and this is again sort of current research, is that when I go through the birth canal, I pick up all kinds of positive bacteria, my mother's bacteria, all right? When I have a C-section, I'm going from inside to outside and I'm missing that exposure. There's some people now talking about the need to inoculate our babies, like if it's a C-section, to literally take some bacteria, you know, from our body and, you know, like put it on the baby's skin. But see, even in birthing, I'm still taking in, like, the amniotic fluid and stuff as I'm being born. Remember, babies turn amniotic fluid over. I mean, they ingest it, put it back up, ingest it, put it back up. So this question of where all that bacteria is, there's some from the placenta, but there's some concern now about this issue of C-sections, because we have so many people having C-sections, and we're missing that. And the other concern that's out there is that a lot of babies get antibiotics very young, and that will kill off some of those positive the bacteria. And look how many people have gut issues in our society now. You're like your generation, there's a ton of them. Question mark. Okay. But that's the piece that we're missing, that, you know, normal progression through there in terms of all these things that are happening. You know, we used to think, oh yeah, I mean, you just got born, I mean, no big deal. And the more we learn, the more complex it gets. Does that help? Okay. Anybody else? Yes. Speak up.
Oh.
If my wife is on the pill, she's flatlined. As a male, I don't have this normal testosterone rise and fall, all right? The girl at the office is not on the pill, and I will become attracted to her. I mean, this is how nature works, okay? Whether you act upon it or not is clearly, I'm not advocating acting upon it necessarily, but to know the biology is there. So the girl in the office is looking mighty good to me once a month, and I'm not feeling this way about my wife anymore. And so, and I don't understand it, but I must have fallen in love with the girl at the office because, you know, I'm interested, I'm sexually interested. Okay?
We're going to end in prayer because I think we need it and our world needs it for sure. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We thank you in deep gratitude, Holy Father, for the gift of tonight, for the mission you have given Vicki Thorn. We pray for her family. We pray for each one of us tonight, especially those of us struggling or questioning relationships, dealing with issues of sexuality, and trying to grow in faith and live according to our teachings. And we pray for protection on each of us and our families as we pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen. I am dying to know, did anyone not learn something tonight? Seriously, come on. All right, good. This is really good. I'm just curious.
Yeah, I knew everything you said. So, I told you, I'm like,
So, okay,
thank you.